Phineas and Ferb is a show I hold very dear. I remember back when I was 11 and moved to secondary school. I was the only one of my old class and friends who moved there, and everything was so new, so different. And I didn't have many friends in the beginning. That's not to say that I got my breakfast stolen from the tough guys or anything. Sure, some people made fun of me here and there, and school can be tough in that age. But in the end, it ultimately made me more confident today. Most of the breaks I was alone. Some people didn't want to hang out with me, and I didn't want to hang out with some others. And getting to know people can be difficult in school when everything is so unfamiliar. Back then, I just wasn't as confident as I am now. Sometimes, things like this just need time. But I kept going. And as time went on, I actually made some really good friends throughout these years. Some new, some I never would have thought I would hang out with one day, but in a good way. And some I already lost contact again with after all these years. But this doesn't have to be a bad thing. Life goes on. People go, people come. Of course, it's even more wonderful if some people and things stay. I am 21 now, and one of the things that stayed from back then I want to talk about was something like this.
There's 104 days of summer vacation before school comes along just to end it. So the annual problem for our generation is finding a good way to spend it.
No matter if a school day was bad or good, once I came home, I knew I was able to watch at least one episode of Phineas and Ferb after that. There was just something about that show that kept me hooked, and I think I know what. Phineas and Ferb aired during a dry time for cartoons. Shows like Gravity Falls, Star Wars The Forces of Evil, and regular show were a far cry, and all the gems from back then already ended or were about to end. There were still good shows here and there, but they were few. And aside from them, I began to notice that so many cartoons at the time tended to be so mean-spirited. But not in a funny or entertaining way. I just didn't feel comfortable watching some of them anymore. And then this show aired. And I finally had this warm feeling while watching a cartoon again. I think the main reason this show not only stood out from the rest that aired at the time, but also connected to me, is because it was so kind-hearted. But why? I really want to start with Candace and Doof, because not only are they the heart and the soul of the show for me, in every episode, Candace basically wants to stop her brother from having a good time, and yeah, Doof tries to take over the city every day and has an evil jingle. Doofenshmirtz Evil Incorporated! So specifically using the term kind-hearted feels strange, right? No. Candace doesn't want to bust Phineas and Ferb out of poor revenge or something. She loves her brothers. She is not only the oldest one, but also growing up and in charge when her parents aren't home. And she likes it. So when Phineas and Ferb are doing their crazy stuff they are doing, she enjoys the thought of putting an end to this sometimes quite reasonable, dangerous stuff and letting her mother know how she took responsibility. Also, she thinks she's the one who has to answer for it when something bad happens to her brothers or others. The result of that is her being quite the control freak. That's just how she is. So of course she will lose her cool and alarm her mother when things go out of her control. Candace wants to bust her brothers not necessarily because they do something wrong, but because she thinks she is doing something right. And that she wasn't lying all the time. Sometimes you can see how proud she is when she thinks she made it. Doofenshmirtz is actually a really tragic character, but never have I felt petty for him. Because while he has been through and done some stuff that isn't okay, Heinz is a good man who doesn't need it. Sure, he's a silly genius who only does the most mundane stuff with his insane inventions, but he too never seeks for harm, but rather what he considers justice, formed by his past. And most of the time he just wants to make life easier in a lunatic way. He definitely has his flaws, but that ultimately makes him human, because he's also a caring father, has a healthy relationship with his ex-wife, and respects and even enjoys his rivalry with Perry. His plans, motivations and failures are portrayed in such an over-the-top manner that we care for him, but it still feels amusing and not down-putting. He doesn't really care because for Doof it's almost some sort of sport. He likes building ridiculous stuff, catching Perry, just so that he can escape and overcome him again. You actually see him more disappointed if Perry doesn't want to stop him. It is silly, crazy and over the top. And because it's fun for Doof, it's also fun for us. We laugh with him and not at him. At least this is how I look at them. And finally, of course, we have the overall positive spirits of the main characters, Phineas and Ferb, who try to make the most of every day to create an unforgettable summer for them and for everyone who likes to join. However, I want to address something that I think is at least worth a discussion. The positive nature of the show mostly thrives from Phineas and Ferb, and their friendly attitude, creativity and positivity. And while I enjoy and support protagonists with that mindset, I always felt like Candace and Doof are the real main characters, for me. First off, while all the problems seem to magically disappear at the end of an episode, I like how every episode begins with our main cast actually starting something. They carry the plot and not the other way around. Well, that is until the mysterious force solves all the problems. Doof and the boys build something while Perry and Candace want to stop them. However, I feel like most of the main characters somehow process throughout the show, except Phineas and Ferb themselves. They have to overcome and learn something, at least every now and then. Candace has her moments where she doesn't want to bust her brothers, or even works with them for a cute and greater cause. She also starts to actually date and hang out with Jeremy and even his family. Doofenshmirtz not only gets some development with Perry, but also his daughter, his ex-wife, and sometimes even Monogram. Now, all of these things don't really have a great impact on the story or evolve beyond anything more than that. But it's something. Phineas and Ferb kinda stay the same all the time. And that's not necessarily a bad thing. They are static characters and they work this way. The episodes aren't really connected to one another. The show returns to the status quo and you can just turn on a random episode and have fun without missing some essential details. This is how the show is supposed to be watched and that is okay. I think the problem is not that they don't develop. Doof and Candace stay pretty much the same too, but here we actually get to see at least another side. SpongeBob is the typical happy-go-lucky protagonist. But sometimes we see that there's also more to him than just that. He's a softie, but he still enjoys karate. He's very friendly and polite, but even he can feel annoyed and even insulted. He has more than just one reaction to the people and things in his world. Sure, at least Phineas gets angry in some of the specials, but it's so rare that it actually feels off character. He's not annoyed or stressed. He's angry, even though he wins through bigger impossible scenarios. No, I know I'm being kinda unfair here. I want to see another side and when it happens, I complain. What I'm trying to say is that his anger doesn't seem believable. And we should have seen a bit more of that during regular episodes to make it feel more natural. Anyway, let me know what you think about this. Before I round this up, I should at least tackle that the show is comedy gold, and why I think so.
It doesn't do any-
I love it! What are we talking about?
And I always think this is kind of a tricky thing, because humor is so subjective and diverse that it's hard to pinpoint why a whole show is funny and not just one joke. But I guess it's fair to say that the comedy ultimately builds on the whole spirit of the show. It's positive. I see so many gags in especially cartoons where the comedy more often than not seems to rely on mean-spirited, random, or shock humor, that often it makes me rather sick than smile. And even if someone is the butt of a joke, it doesn't drag on and on and on. No matter what kind of humor you enjoy, I think we can all agree that the key to most good jokes is timing. The right moment. And the people behind the show have a really good feeling for that. For example, I love how every time Doofenshmirtz reveals even the most mundane things, it's supported by some evil orchestral choir.
The ultimate suburban weapon! The atomic leaf blowerinator!
Same goes for Perry and his action score. The show uses that stuff a lot. And of course, a lot of the comedy also comes from the episodic structure, and how the show realizes it and mixes it up. This is actually a thing many people seem to criticize it for. And I can understand where they are coming from. Everyone and their grandma knows this pattern. Something happens. I know what we're gonna do today. Hey, where's Perry? Candace wants to bust her brothers. Some song. Perry stops Doof and his newest innator, which also leads to the destruction of the brothers' invention. Oh, there you are, Perry. Mom makes cake. And doing a strict formula like this every episode is actually really dangerous, because it likely gets predictable, and therefore the jokes too. But the writers actually managed to spice it up so that it is still entertaining almost every time. This is one hilarious Stone Age episode where you can almost exactly tell what the characters are saying, even though they just speak some Neanderthal gibberish. Even the songs are like this, it's wonderful. They mastered and furthermore realized their formula and knew when to mix it up. And to accomplish something like this for that long is just impressive to me. And that's why I'm even more glad that the show knew when to say goodbye. Especially because it's so formulaic, it could have easily been put on life support and just go on and on and on and lose its soul. But it didn't. Part of the journey is the end. And Phineas and Ferb's summer ended with a bang and made room for new fantastic stories to tell.
Summer is done.
Ach yeah. All the memories and drawings I made with the show. The finale still makes me teary-eyed. Phineas and Ferb accompanied me while slowly growing up. It made me laugh, gave me a lot of banger songs I hear to this day, entertained me, but most importantly, it just made me happy, dude.
Oh, come on.
Also, I love how the show sometimes went absolutely bananas. People always want to see a live-action version of something animated, but I absolutely love how this show embraces the fact that it is a cartoon, starting with the crazy character designs, to all the awesome improbable adventures they have. Something like this just works better with animation. I always had a smile watching this show. A little side story. It took the co-creators of the show, Dan Povenmire and Jeff Swampy Marsh, 15 years for the dream show to get aired. One evening in the 90s. Dan Povenmire was just doodling a simple figure on simple butcher paper that laid on his table. A kid with big eyes, scruffy hair, and a triangular shaped head. That simple scribble was the very first picture of our Phineas. Even back then, Dan and Swampy knew each other and worked together on Rock of Modern Life. They were already good friends and proved their skills as writers for comedy and songs. They also already had this idea of their own show and stories they had to tell. But their paths eventually separated, as Phineas and Ferb was always rejected by the networks. Swampy moved to England while Dan went to work on Family Guy. But their idea, their dream, never left them, and they always kept their portfolio of Phineas and Ferb, just in case. And after 13 years, Disney wanted to give the show a chance with an 11-minute pilot. They finally got the chance to work together on the show they planned for so long. And what a ride it was. For them and for us. I want to end the video here and leave you with this story. It's a dream of mine too, to hopefully create a cartoon one day. Just like many people out there, I have stories, characters, and maybe even the one or other lessons and experience to share. And until then, I still have my videos to share my interests and thoughts with other creative people out there. It is still a long road and I still have to learn a lot, but hopefully I will make it someday. And I hope you will too, whatever your goal is. It took over a decade. But in the end, Phineas and Ferb made it and is still one of the best cartoons ever created for me, and many others. Thank you to everyone who worked on the show. And to everyone listening, I hope you too make the most of every day. Thank you so much for watching my video. Power out.